Hi everyone, and welcome back. I'm very glad to see you all again here in this video. Depending on the iteration of this course that you are taking, this is the first installment in this segment on Utopia and Dystopia, and you would have probably come at it either after having looked at science fiction and before venturing out to have a look at probably short fiction, but the order may be a different one, doesn't really matter. However, I'm very happy to be offering this first installment in this segment on Utopia Dystopia, and over the next 30, maybe 45 minutes or so, we're basically just going to hang out together and have a look at these two concepts. So here we are going to look at a very staple and traditional classic notion or concept in literary studies, Utopia Dystopia. But I'm mentioning them both in the same breath, Utopia Dystopia. That's what I will be saying throughout this presentation, because the boundaries between those two concepts isn't as clear-cut as one might think, isn't really as precise or as analytically sharp as one might expect. And we're going to have a look at why that is probably the case and how we can unpack this claim. And because the distinction isn't that easy to make, I would also like to think about some of the spaces, places, and shades in between. Because I personally think that this is the much more interesting approach than to just be rambling off a definition that is entirely unsatisfactory and then move on from there. For as we shall see, the concept of utopia has been riddled with ambiguities ever since its inception, ever since its first coining, if you will. And so was the notion of dystopia too, that follows in its waters, if you will. And dystopia kind of inhabits utopia as utopia inhabits dystopia. And now that sounds very complicated, but hang on, we'll get there. The point is that both slide into each other, and frequently therefore make it hard to tell where the one begins and the other really ends. We will therefore comment on conceptual origins and conceptual relations too in this video, trying to find out something about functions, using as many examples as humanly possible, trying to make as much sense as we can out of these examples over the limited space of time that we have at our disposal. But let's see how we go. We won't be able to comment on everything that one could, needless to say. And you shouldn't think of this presentation as a formal lecture in the classical or technical sense. Because whatever I'm going to say is not at all exhaustive or comprehensive, and I'm laying no such claim to be able to just aim at offering something like this, okay? This is not the aim of this presentation. So whatever I'm going to say is neither particularly formal, nor is this in any way authoritative. There are other interpretations out there, and you should always feel free to check those out and always cross-reference, because that is what we do in academia, that is good academic practice. But since I get the opportunity to talk a little about utopia, dystopia, in the context of this course, I thought it would be an interesting thing to maybe just walk you through a couple of the things that I find particularly challenging and interesting to think about when thinking about utopia and dystopia and the many shades, spaces, and places in between, to see where one arrives and to see where one ends up at. So needless to say that what I'm going to present here is, as I said, not really a lecture, but more a discussion in the more loose and casual sense. But I still hope that you'll enjoy it, and I hope that there is something productive to be taken out of this. Walking you through a couple of the things that I find challenging in thinking about utopia and dystopia, I'm reminded of British cultural studies legend Stuart Hall and his idea or notion of open-ended theorization. So maybe this is an exercise here, an exercise in open-ended theorization, not towards a specific goal, but for the purpose of entertaining the intellectual challenge as an end in itself. So I'd like to offer some fuel for thought, or some fuel basically for or towards such an open-ended theorization. Because otherwise, I'd be rambling off a rough, preliminary, and rather unsatisfactory definition, and this would be the end of this video. I'd say something like, broadly, utopia is, in the tradition of Western literary studies, associated with the imagination, construction, representation, da-da-da-da-da, of an ideal future, an ideal society, the best possible world, often presented in, though not always, in the form of science fiction and or alternative world fiction. And I would say that, in contradistinction, dystopia in Western literary studies is associated with such fictional scenarios that depict, in a nutshell, worst-case versions, bleak and dark futures, post-apocalyptic scenarios based on a speculation as to what the most negative trajectory of current affairs could be, oftentimes involving authoritarian governments, oppression, dictatorial regimes, as recurring and staple dystopian tropes and imagery. Again, often but not always presented in the form of science and or alternative world fiction. Also, I would probably say that it all goes back to the famous 16th century book Utopia, written by the famous English humanist scholar, cleric and politician Sir Thomas More, or Thomas Morus. As humanities majors, you should definitely keep this name in mind. It is just something that we should know. The book was first published in 1516 and has ever since, without doubt, been an indispensable point of reference. As the back matter of my 2001 Yale University Press edition says, Utopia is one of the most important works of European humanism. Utopia seems remarkably contemporary, nearly 5 centuries after it was written, and it remains a foundational text in philosophy and political theory. And then that would be the end of this video, leaving us with the impression that Thomas More, through his book Utopia, gifted us a groundbreaking political treatise in which he describes an ideal society and ideal political organization from which we have derived in literary cultural studies an inspiration to analyze and critique different narrative texts, different works of fiction as utopian because they imagine an ideal future, or dystopian because they do the opposite. But things are a bit more complicated than that. And I have a feeling that there is a lot of wishful thinking, no pun intended, in this shortcut. If this shortcut rings, however, familiar, thinking back to your high school days, that's because, well, you were fed a shortcut there, and a simplification. Don't worry, we all were. That's the cool thing about being at uni now. That's where we get to challenge these things. For starters, looking at the Greek term utopia, we notice that we are not actually reading oitopia. So the title does not translate as good place, but as no place instead. The text of the book does actually mention this fact right at the beginning, where we read a short prefatory poem, where the mysterious island of Utopia, assuming here the position of an autodiegetic narrator, comments on itself. The poem reads as follows. Called once no place because I stood apart, now I compete with Plato's state, perhaps surpass it. What he only wrote about, I have alone, in fact, become the best in people, wealth, in laws, by far the best, good place, by rights, I should be called. Thus, the original text of Utopia already subverts the idea that we are presented with a depiction of an ideal place that exists somewhere. Much rather, the suggestion seems to be that whatever is presented here is literally nowhere. It exists nowhere, and that it is nowhere to be found, right? Good place it should be called, as it claims, but isn't, because it is, after all, the no place that stands apart. As Clarence H. Miller notes in his introduction to the 2001 Yale University Press edition, here's a quote, "Moore's utopia does not fit the ordinary meaning of the word as it came down in modern languages, where it signifies an unreservedly good place, and Moore's utopia should not be read, as it often has been and sometimes still is read, as presenting Moore's notion of a purely positive and desirable society." End of quote. Famous Australian literary critic and postcolonial scholar Bill Ashcroft argues along similar lines in his book Utopianism in Postcolonial Literatures. Here is another quote for you. He argues that, indeed, the word utopia has become the universal term for the ideal, whether achievable or not, the very embodiment of social aspirations to a perfect community. Moore invented the word utopia or no place as opposed to oitopia or good place, but the genre of utopianism has come to refer to utopia as an ideal possibility of human community. The idea of perfection has given the term the character of a dream or an illusion, but still the term persists in Western consciousness as the very definition of the possibility of a better world. Just in case you're interested, there is an interview we did with Bill Ashcroft when he came to visit us in Cologne. Bill is actually a founding figure of post-colonial literary studies, and he is, besides that, a very generous scholar who very generously shared with us a couple of thoughts his career and post-colonialism as such. And however, some of the things are very revealing, and I just want to highly encourage you to go to our website, centerforaustralianstudies.org, where we are offering a wide range of interviews, podcasts, and other materials, audiovisual and print publications, all related to Australian studies. So if you're keen to check this out, that's where you will find it. I will link the interview somewhere, either right here on the screen or in a description in the course segment. Anyway, what I want us to note at this point is that the standard reference to Moore's original work in answering the question, well, what is utopia, in the sense of a speculative, political, social, or what have you ideal, is both inaccurate and a shortcut generalization. Understanding its intention solely as portraying an ideal society doesn't make much sense. Right to the point, Bill Ashcroft points out that, quote, the most persistent question to haunt the reading of Utopia is, what did he mean by it? Did Moore really mean it to be the picture of an ideal society? Is it a satire or a serious plan for social improvement? Miller's 2001 introduction attempts an answer here. Miller argues that the experience of the book is not supposed to give the reader a view of the perfect society or analyze what is good or bad about utopia. Rather, the work encourages taking a view on social and political problems by seeing alleged and strange solutions to them, and challenges the reader to try and find out what they approve or disapprove of and why. End quote. In another introduction to Moore's work by Edward Sertz, it is therefore argued and suggested that, quote, utopia is an open-ended work, or better, a dialogue with an indeterminate close. Moore asks the right questions, which can never be answered fully. Well, open-ended theorization, right? But we haven't come full circle just yet. For we note how the notion of utopia-dystopia triggers a thought or two about other issues such as normativity, subjectivity, and so forth. What may be a utopian vision for one reader might be an utter dystopia for another reader. But beyond mere or simplistic relativism, our two commentators so far here make sure to stress how both aspects co-occur, exist simultaneously in Moore's book, and slide into each other frequently. The one undercuts and subverts the other, for which reason the book rejects and escapes the confines of an easy, ready-to-go template for ideal world fantasies. If we were on the lookout for something that comes close to a tradition or a structural pattern that we could identify as originating in Moore, then stretching across the so-called literary canon, landing right in our Netflix playlists via the filters of popular culture, it is probably this dynamism and ambiguity, this very productive double-bind and co-occurrence of utopian-dystopian elements. And it is therefore interesting to note how the issue of interpretation is an ongoing one. As again Bill Ashcroft states, quote, the debate over whether utopia is a playful satire or a serious proposal for an ideal community persists to the present day and goes right to the heart of the problem with utopias, end quote. Well, that Moore put a great deal of criticism of what he saw as appalling and deplorable conditions of the England of his day is not at all hard to gauge from reading the pages of Utopia, and not particularly controversial either. So one might infer a pattern of the book according to which what is praised in the island of Utopia must be, in reverse, an object of critique for the England of Moore's time, right? It is frequently argued that this is actually how what we call utopian or dystopian sci-fi works, right? The idea being that a bright and glorious or bleak and gloomy vision of the future is not only about the actual future, but just as much, if not more so, about a present state of affairs. That the futuristic scenario makes a point about and critiques present-day politics, economy, use of technology, and so forth. That the vision of the future amplifies our understanding of contemporary issues. Bill Ashcroft also talks about this in his book, from which you are likely going to read the introduction anyway. So I'll instead quote the eminent literary critic Frederick Jameson, who has an interesting thought on offer in his book Archaeologies of the Future, The Desire Called Utopia and Other Science Fictions, where he says, quote, nothing in the mind that was not first in the senses, If true, this principle spells the end not only of utopia as a form, but of science fiction in general, affirming as it does that even our wildest imaginings are all collages of experience, constructs made up of bits and pieces of the here and now. End quote. Think about the Star Trek universe, for example. Well, Earth has left behind poverty, abolished crime, healed the environment. There is free energy and abundance in space travel, scientific advance, an interplanetary and interspecies commonwealth or empire, federation, spreading across the light years, and all that without capitalism, a money-free economy. But because of my post-colonial studies background, I can't help but notice the reproduction of much early 18th century Earth colonial imagery and rhetoric. The very idea of exploring the uncharted frontiers and vast expanses of the seas, or space for that matter. The frequent allusions to 17th and 18th century naval traditions, remote bases and colonies, not to mention the self-righteousness, smugness, and moral hypocrisy of many a Star Trek franchise captain. The increasing militarization, duty to king and country, liberty and uniform, and focus on interstellar war to defend the freedom of a united federation of planets and its values. I wonder if the fact that Star Trek Deep Space Nine, which aired from 1993 to 1999, and its massive tilt in that direction in its final seasons, had anything to do with the end of the Second Gulf War or Operation Desert Storm just 2 years earlier. The nation-building function of literature and art has been well and frequently discussed, and cultural production as a site of collective consciousness and memory, and the production of the two remains an important and vital thing to think about. Was there a need, perhaps, to retrospectively justify conflict and account for the past? The fact that the United States of America, the United Federation of Planets, is not the invasion force here, but merely the last defense against tyranny in this scenario surely helps. Let it be as much 24th century as you will. I can't shake the feeling that Star Trek and the Star Trek universe across the board carries along and projects into its futurism much of what is actually culturally and politically deplorable today. And what is at stake and open to debate is the ability of such scenarios then to really think beyond the cultural and political confines that shape them and their production now. But like any intellectually challenging fiction, Star Trek and the Star Trek universe also engages frequently in acts of self-critique and confronts these questions head-on. Just let's have a look at this wee clip here.
Any place that doesn't stock a good cigar doesn't rank high in my book.
If you must have one, I'm sure we can replicate it for you.
Oh, you think that one of these imitations can take the place of a hand-wrapped Havana? Oh.
I wouldn't know.
Well, that's the problem I see here. All this technology only serves to take away life's simple pleasures. You don't even let a man open the door for a lady.
I think what we've gained far outweighs anything that might have been lost.
Huh? Well, I'm not so impressed with this future. Huge starships and weapons that can no doubt destroy entire cities, and military conquest as a way of life.
Is that what you see here?
Well, I know what you say, that this is a vessel of exploration and that your mission is to discover new worlds. That's what the Spanish said.
Deck 36.
And the Dutch and the Portuguese. It's what all conquerors say. I'm sure that's what you told that blue-skinned fellow I just saw before you brought him here to serve you.
He's one of the thousands of species that we've encountered. We live in a peaceful federation with most of them. The people you see are here by choice.
So there are privileged few who serve on these ships, living in luxury and wanting for nothing. But what about everybody else? What about the poor? You ignore them.
Poverty was eliminated on Earth a long time ago, and a lot of other things disappeared with it. Hopelessness, despair, cruelty?
Young lady, I come from a time when men achieved power and wealth by standing on the backs of the poor, where prejudice and intolerance are commonplace and power is an end unto itself. And you're telling me that isn't how it is anymore?
That's right.
Maybe. It's worth giving up cigars for, after all.
As Ashcroft continues, there is no question that Moore's criticism of the contemporary state of affairs in England was serious and deeply felt. Clearly, whether satire or fabulation, Utopia addressed a very pressing need in Moore's mind. And I think Ashcroft's argument is helpful, a very helpful one in acknowledging that so great are the contradictions that it is hard to not see Moore's description as both serious and playful, the two tendencies working in an intricate, ambivalent, and unresolved conflict in the book. Maybe Utopia and Dystopia, therefore, are not so much specific and clear-cut functions of a book or any given narrative, but ways of reading, approaching, critiquing, and or unpacking. So we note how Moore's Utopia is not easily the mother of all this-is-how-it-should-be fictions. Explaining the concept Utopia with reference to Moore's work is... Explaining the concept Utopia with reference to Moore's work, as in this is where it all began, is inaccurate because there are even earlier, less ambivalent cultural texts than Utopia. Moore himself offers Plato's State or Politeia as a direct intertextual reference, and the history of political philosophy since and before Thomas More is replete with such projects. After Plato, but definitely before Moore, the famous Arabic Islamic philosopher Al-Farabi wrote his work on the virtuous city, and the philosophy majors among you will be even more familiar with Thomas Hobbes and his Leviathan. In order to end what Hobbes views as the so-called natural state, in which there is always war of everyone against everyone, everyone should, in a nutshell, surrender their individual powers to a common power, an all-powerful and ruling sovereign, who will, in the best interest of the people, and with and by their mandate, rule justly, and thus maintain peace, and end the natural state of war of everyone against everybody else. What for us obviously sounds more like a highly authoritarian dystopia featuring a cheap excuse for a dictatorial regime must, however, be read with some attention to the context of its time. Hobbes would have been acutely aware of the atrocities of the 30 Years' War, which was, during his lifetime, taking Central Europe apart. Standard estimates list between 4.5 to 8 million casualties, and that includes civilians and soldiers. And in some areas of Germany alone, around 60% of the population were wiped out. Let's have a look now at a couple of classics from the Utopia-Dystopia literary canon, and see what else we can comment on. These are just a number of standard texts we likely remember from our high school days, like Aldous Huxley's Brave New World, George Orwell's 1984, Margaret Atwood's The Handmaid's Tale, or more recent works like the Hunger Games series, or other classics of dystopian sci-fi like Walter Tavis's Mockingbird. These are just some of the ones that stick, and they help us a great deal to push our investigation a little further. Because there are always more problems and issues to tap right into. That is the cool thing about the humanities. George Orwell's 1984 is another great example to see how utopian and dystopian elements can relate to each other. That is to say, how in this particular narrative, so-called utopian elements or visions beget a horrific dystopia, or in other words, how one can expose totalitarianism, destruction, oppression, and violence behind a utopian facade of progress, development, equity, that a system in question allegedly achieved and must therefore defend. A facade that is to a large extent based in language, linguistically encoded, built on language and perpetuated, made true, as it were, through language and discourse. I'm not suggesting that there are things in this narrative of 1984 that are actually desirable. The thing is that the narrative makes this crucial point about how hope and aspirations for a better future way of life can be and are abused to establish and maintain power, to fuel a war machinery, to streamline emotions. Think, for instance, of the Ministry of Truth in 1984, whose job is, however, propaganda and the production, the manufacturing, and the enforcing of consent. There is a great book by Edward S. Herman and Noam Chomsky by the title Manufacturing Consent, The Political Economy of the Mass Media, a study published in 1888. Just have a look at it sometime and see for yourself how thin the line between dystopian fiction and reality can sometimes be. Thinking of Orwell's 1984, maybe this is what utopian dystopian fiction does and what it is so good at, effectively making us challenge lines between fact and fiction. Again, think of the so-called Ministry of Plenty, also in 1984. Their job is to manage and maintain abject poverty, while manufacturing and violently enforcing the fact, quote-unquote, that people live in abundance thanks to INGSOC, short for English Socialism. Novels like 1984, then, are about cultures, structures, and architectures of systematic delusion. And novels like 1984 then maybe help us to think about what can happen if critical thinking and ongoing critique of our politics go into cardiac arrest, induced by all the Instagramming, influencing, Facebooking, all that social media overkill in a way. Never mind my polemics at this point. I'm very happy to own it and my own hypocrisies. Needless to say, yes, I am listening to music via YouTube as I'm typing this. Importantly, utopian dystopian narratives can force us, though, to critically interrogate our own relation to and position within a web of social, political, cultural, technological, and economic norms. What do we accept as right? How and on which terms do we relate to each other? How do we access information? How and by which means do we act on the basis of that? How can we act? What about the problem of perspective, though? Let's assume that thinking about utopias and dystopias involves reflecting upon the position from which we look at it. Depends on the positions from which we are receiving a piece of fiction, a work, and from which we are analyzing it. For we could ask whose ideal future, whose bleakest doomsday scenario, whose worst case scenario, whose future, whose past, whose present, and which teaching, which doctrine, which discourse about it, right? Which valuation according to which ideology, which interpretation according to which dogmatic standard, which analysis according to whose allegedly universal standpoint. Take, for instance, the main reading for this session, Ambulin Quai Molina's The Interrogation of a Shayla Wolf, a post-apocalyptic, however rebuilt world and society after the so-called reckoning, a cataclysmic climate catastrophe. People learned from their mistakes, right? Societies are now constructed in a sustainable way, and adherence and obedience to the so-called balance on an almost religious scale organizes the social and political decision-making mechanisms of this world. Sounds quite utopian, or does it not? What about, however, the fact that people with special abilities are being hunted down and held in detention camps since they are considered a threat to the balance, a dangerous deviation from the natural order of things? We note here that the question of what this order of things is supposed to be is automatically bound up with issues of control, ideology, and power. The power to interpret what is and what is not within the balance, within the natural order of things, is in this particular novel depicted as oppressive and almost dictatorial. People are kept under the profound impression that a genuine achievement towards the better and that deep post-reckoning transformative change has been achieved. However, patterns of domination, colonialism, and deep structures of power are retained in this version of the maybe not so distant future. Tina is going to talk in a lot more detail and in a lot more depth about this book, so I'll just leave it at that. However, I will say that I highly invite you and encourage you to do a little bit of a random Google search about a historical person by the name of A.O. Neville, and just have a little think about how that might influence or actually change even your reading of the novel. And I'd be very interested to learn about your reactions to such a cross-referencing or a cross-reading like that in the forums, if you feel like it. I never tire of admiring utopian, dystopian narratives' ability to comment on, about, and speculate about the implications of big tech like really nothing else. Another way to frame this would be that I never tire of applying utopia, dystopia as a critical reading lens to issues and questions of big tech, not simply in narrative fiction, not just in books, but also in life in general. Sticking with fiction, however, let's have a look actually at Walter Tevis's classic Mockingbird. It's not an Australian example, it's a United States American piece of science fiction, but for the sake of the argument, I think that's perfectly okay. Lucas will talk a lot more about Australian utopia dystopia, so we can indulge here a little. First published in 1980, this science fiction novel critically interrogates the adverse effects of automation, robotics, as I've just mentioned, and the uncritical use and abuse of robotics and artificial intelligence on human life. It frames, in many ways, human interaction and existence under the rule of robots and technology as an almost zombie-like form of being in which things like critical thinking, autonomy, self-reflexivity, and political agency, things we take for granted and usually understand to be an integral part of what it means to be human, are being strategically and systematically undermined and taken away, basically stripped off human beings. And these things and these features in the scenario of Mockingbird are systematically unlearned too. And of course, I will say, please go ahead and check out our bus video on zombies if you would like to learn more about this particular concept and see for yourselves if my analogy here actually makes sense. Mockingbird isn't simply and only a dark technology takeover fantasy, but inquires deep into the potential effects of unchecked and unquestioned technological advance. As one human character addresses one of the novel's robot protagonists, "Hell," Arthur was saying, "you robots will be running everything in another 30 years. People can't do shit for themselves anymore." A bit earlier, the same robot protagonist is described by our heterodiegetic narrator with reference to yet another famous intertext. Like the Frankenstein monster, he was given active life by electrical shock. He emerged from his tank fully grown and able to talk, a bit thickly at first. In the vast and cluttered factory room where he was being brought into awareness, his dark eyes looked around him with excitement and life. Arguably, Mockingbird is about how deregulated technological advance and uncritical admittance of robotic assistance into all realms of human life has come around to haunt humanity and our collective imagination. Please check out our other bus video about haunting if you're interested, and do let me know in a forum post or so if this take makes any sense, or if you'd rather like to challenge it. My whole point here is that within the fictional future world of Mockingbird, where humans take to acts of self-immolation and protest and or out of sheer depression, feeling useless, mind-controlled, without meaning, point or purpose, technology and robotic assistance was praised at some point in the narrative's distant past as the ultimate and beautiful peak of human ingenuity that would make life easy and pleasurable on unknown scales. Oscar Wilde wrote about this. In The Soul of Man Under Socialism, the famous Irish playwright speculates that when all lesser tasks that are an insult to the noble mind of the human being are finally outsourced to machines, humans will finally be able to perfect and cultivate what is good and noble about them. All work of that kind, Wilde writes, should be done by a machine, and I have no doubt that it will be so. At present, machinery competes against man. Under proper conditions, machinery will serve man. End quote. And then finally, he says, it will be a marvelous thing, the true personality of man, when we see it. It will grow naturally and simply, flower-like, or as the tree grows. It will not be at discord. It will never argue or dispute. It will not prove things. It will know everything. Well, back to the issue of perspective and standpoint. Well, Mark Zuckerberg's and Elon Musk's heaven are sure enough my personal hell. I will always defend Oscar Wilde as one of the greatest writers and critics of the Anglo-European literary tradition, one of the greatest writers and thinkers that this tradition has ever seen. But I also think that Neil Blomkamp's film Elysium does a very decent job at pointing out that a human-built paradise must select the chosen few and build a wall around their heaven to exclude and ward off all the other unworthy ones, For as long as deregulated capitalism and economic rationalism are our predominant social architectures. And I'm not necessarily talking about capitalism as an economic model, as a theory of the exchange of goods, but as a form of relating to each other, as the very terms on which we meet and interact with each other. Before I conclude this already way too long video, I want to offer a quick comment on something that I personally think is one of the bigger, or maybe the biggest problem involved in this discussion about utopia and dystopia so far. Thinking about utopia and dystopia, we immediately conjure up futuristic scenarios, are we not? Many, if not all, the canonical classics of utopian dystopian fiction are set in the near or distant future. There are, of course, exceptions to that rule, but a general trend, I think, seems to support my argument here at this point. This leads us to an association of utopia-dystopia with usually science fiction, and locates a given scenario in the temporal no place. Thinking back to what utopia actually translates as, the no place, this leads us to making a connection here to something that has not yet happened, something that does not yet exist, and relegates whatever scenario we are looking at to that temporal no place. But it is my contestation here that precisely this structure, enabled by the temporal no place, is highly problematic. In principle, and especially if viewed through or from the viewpoint of post-colonial criticism. And here is why. In the aforementioned dynamic, apocalypse has not yet happened. It might be still possible to avert it. We consume a utopian dystopian fiction, maybe, with the same thrill and morbid pleasure that allows us to enjoy horror fiction too, knowing that we will be perfectly safe. We enjoy the immersion, being immersed into the scenario while it lasts. Not yet. Maybe never. It's all good, we tell ourselves. Yet this perfectly West and Eurocentric analysis of apocalypse in the future anterior sense, the distant future endgame, is marked by a particular form of ignorance that denies the possibility that apocalypse is something that might have already happened to other people in the not-so-distant past, something that is still ongoing, implying that some people on this planet are by definition already living in what we would call a post-apocalyptic reality. What if I told you that this is actually the case? Here you can see an artistic rendition and an actual replica of the famous Mayflower, the vessel that carried the so-called Pilgrim Fathers from Plymouth in England to the North American continent in 1620. Instead of their original destination, Virginia, they rocked up at what is today's Cape Cod in the state of Massachusetts. The rest is history, one says too easily. And here we are looking at the birth of one of the biggest cultural narratives and fictions ever known. The Pilgrim Fathers, their utopian journey to the new world where they would build, the chosen ones that they are, a home for the righteous so they can practice the true religion of God, a branch of English Puritanism in their case, free from persecution and oppression. Thanksgiving, the first Thanksgiving meal, you name it, it all starts here. Yet themselves oppressed they would. For what they also initiated was a long, bloody, sad, and gruesome history of dispossession, the genocide of Native Americans. Needless to say, they followed in the wake of earlier so-called explorers who, quote-unquote, discovered the New World, the likes of Christopher Columbus, who brought with them destruction, death, and basically, if you will, the end of the world for many indigenous peoples. The age of European imperialism and expansionism, framed as the Golden Age of Exploration, coincides with the onset of European colonialism, which in turn coincides with the land grab, the exploitation of people and resources, with genocidal practices of subjugation. As Potawatomi scholar Kyle Powys White argues, for precisely this reason, the present time is for many indigenous peoples, quote-unquote, already dystopian. White uses the example of the unfolding climate crisis and the so-called Anthropocene. Please go ahead and check out our bus video here. And he argues that, quote, some indigenous people then offer the idea that we confront climate change having already passed through environmental and climate crises arising from the impacts of colonialism, end quote. Suggesting here that many indigenous communities in North America and elsewhere are already living, and not just in the manner of speaking, post-apocalyptic lives. How does it change our understanding of utopia and dystopia if we pause here and let sink in for a moment White's argument that a cyclical history of colonial strategies and ongoing cyclical colonialism make many indigenous communities look at looming climate catastrophe not as a distant apocalyptic dystopia, but as the experience of a colonial déjà vu, something caused by a colonial structure of domination, something that's already happened, something that's already there. In a compelling way, scholars Heather Davis and Zoe Todd also take the example of impending climate catastrophe, which is needless to say currently occupied and explored by much speculative dystopian science fiction, or what has more or less recently been called climate fiction. Go ahead and check out our bus video on that too. Following the work of indigenous critics, Davis and Todd argue against the grain of a mainstream and West or Eurocentric imaginary that the Anthropocene is not a new event, but is rather the continuation of practices of dispossession and genocide coupled with a literal transformation of the environment that have been at work for the last 500 years. End quote. Arguments like these in mind, A Shallow Wolf by Amberlynn Quaimalena or Terra Nullius by Claire G. Coleman, challenge us to keep questioning notions like dystopian, as in futuristic, and or speculative, or even science fiction as a genre itself. How speculative, really, is the scenario of an alien invasion force enslaving humans on Earth to mine the planet's resources, incarcerating children in quote-unquote mission schools, and oppressing the natives in the context of spaces like North America and or Australia, whose very national history is founded on settler colonialism and the systematic dispossession of indigenous populations? As the Australian cultural historian Anna Habig argues in her book Dancing in Shadows, History of Noongar Performance, here comes a quote, "The past feels close in Perth. Less than 200 years ago, the city was swampy wetland, home to the ancient lineages of Noongar Whadjuk people for over 50,000 years. Then came the catastrophe of colonization." I could go on. As promised, this presentation has been rather rough on the edges, and if anything, I've been selective. In a course environment such as this, your own reading and critical engagement with the material is going to make all the difference. So this is where I will leave you now, I guess, and kindly invite you to head over to the forum and discuss this further among yourselves. Maybe some of this inspired you to think more about utopia, dystopia, and the vast, messy spaces in between. Maybe it resonated with things that you too had in mind or thoughts you had already been thinking before too. Maybe you flatly reject some or all of what I've just said. In either case, feel free to get in touch with me if you wish to share your thoughts or just share it in the forums with everybody else. So I guess this is where I say thank you very much for watching this video and thank you so much for sticking around until the end of this rather rough and messy and rough on the edges presentation. Depending on the iteration of this course, you will now hear a lot more from Lucas on Australian utopia and dystopia before Tina will offer you an in-detail and in-depth reading of Amberlynn Quaimalena's The Interrogation of a Shallow Wolf. I've referenced this novel a couple of times here in my own presentation, but needless to say that Tina will have an awful lot more to say about this particular novel, so stay tuned for that. This is where I say again, thank you very much. Have a beautiful day and see you later.